All right, I guess we get started here. Just bow our heads and pray real quick. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we just thank you, Father God, for giving us a healthy state of mind, Father God. We thank you for opening up our eyes that we may see, our ears that we may hear, and our heart that we may receive. We just thank you, Father God, for this opportunity to come together and discuss your word. We just come to you, Father God, with this attitude of thanks.
Yes.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
Thank you. Oh, Father God, no words that really you can express.
Yes, Lord.
How we love you and appreciate you for loving us.
Yes,
yes, Lord.
Now, Father God, just give us, or give me the words to express the concept of your love.
Yes, God.
The ingredients that make up what you call marriage, Father God. Just touch each and every one here and touch those that want to be here. We just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Amen. All right. I want some strong discussion on this. Before I get into my lesson, we have a marriage class. The name of this class is What Love Got to Do with It. But a question came up that I would really like to discuss right now. Bring it up. The question is, do you have to know your mate to have a successful marriage?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, you say yes. Why? Come on, create some discussion. Why?
Can I ask a question before she answers this?
Yeah.
Are you saying we have to know them before we get
married? Yeah, before you get married. Do you have to know your mate before you get married?
Yeah. Completely.
I mean, you never know anybody completely.
Well, I'm sorry.
I mean, that's kind of a new statement there, completely. I guess that takes it out of the ballpark. We might as well go sit down and go home. But do you have to know them before you get married? You say yes. Why? Pastor, you'll get ready. Get ready, Pastor.
I can say,
you said yes.
You can know somebody for a long time. I mean, you can date for 3 months, 1 month, a month and a half, even 8 months. You can date them all that time, but when you start living with them, if you start living with them, or like you said, if you get married, people change. You know, people do. So that's why I remember when I first came here in 1980, 84, 86, and I went to one of the classes that Pastor Hill taught, and I always bring this up. He said it's better to marry than to burn. But he always says it's better to get married but within months or so than making it a long term, because you still don't know that person.
All right, she kind of put it on both ends, saying you know some, but you don't know enough, or you don't know any, because like you kind of hint on, you can be with somebody 3 years and still really never really know them, right? Mm-hmm. That's kind of what you're saying. So that's gonna be processes of change. People gonna change. Only real change I see people going through and dealing in marriage is change between salvation. Other than that, people never really change. It's just they rebuild.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But we won't go there. Go ahead.
Answer to that question is no.
I was gonna say.
Go ahead. Why not explain yourself?
Because you got to know Jesus. Mm. And when you know Jesus, okay, nobody's going to come in your space that's a fool, with all this kind of baggage and nonsense and the whole ball of wax. So, no.
I can excuse you on that. No. I'll just excuse you on that.
Because you can be a preacher and the approach up there's going with everybody in the church.
She said, if you know Jesus.
And you know Jesus.
No, but
Hey, what's the prophet's name? Here, real quick, what's the prophet's name in the Old Testament that God had Mary a prostitute?
Gomer.
So that kind of shoots your theory down right there. So, you know, a lot of the time God had you marry somebody who is holier than thou, and there they're going to have baggages, and your responsibility is to be strong in the Lord to mentor. But that's all about what this class is all about. About getting, when you get married, you got to be strong as an individual, because if your mate does fall, you got to be in a position to minister to them, bring them up. But unfortunately, I mean, I will say it now, we go into marriage with our heart in the wrong place. So when our mate does fall, we're too hurt to help them. And then we become hurting people that want to hurt people instead of hurting people that want to minister. But let's go back. So we really haven't asked this question. No. Do you have to be married?
Do you have to know a person?
Or do you have to know a person to get married?
Your question was,
do you have to know
how long do you need to know a person before you get
long?
Married?
Yeah. Well, time is not very relevant, because knowing them is the ultimate thing. How long do you have to know them? I mean, Pastor Hill, come on, help me.
I was thinking, how long do you have to know them to know you know them before you actually take that step?
I think you spend a lifetime getting to know people. I mean, it's not, they're not going to reveal everything to you at the time that you're dating. They're going to put forth their best. I mean, and that's how a lot of us women get tricked up, because we see.
We see this
good side of this person, and then when we get married, then you know, everything, the door is wide open. Mm-hmm. So I think you spend a lifetime learning a person. But there are so many arranged marriages, so I have to say no, because a lot of people don't really know each other before they get married. And when you think of these arranged marriages, I mean, it's set up for them. They don't know who they're marrying.
All right, I'm going to give you the statistics right now. These statistics I have is kind of skewed, because I got them way back, maybe close to 10 years ago when I got them, but I can get close to it. In Europe, there was something like 20% of the population go to church on Sunday, and the divorce rate was like 50%. In America, something like 40% of the population go to church on Sunday, and the divorce rate was 52%. In arranged marriage countries, because not only Muslims do it, but arranged marriage countries where they don't go to church at all, but they have arranged marriages based on their society, Divorce rate like 2%.
2%. Wow. What do you account that for?
Because in marriage, and what God originally created marriage for, because out of marriage, and that's what I'm trying to emphasize in this class, out of marriage comes the neighborhood. Out of marriage comes the society. If you build the God kind of marriage, what we're supposed to be developing, you create a surrounding that's going to support that marriage. So out of marriage in these other countries, they create a society that supports the marriage. And then create a society that supports the marriage, you don't have divorce, because it's not allowed. When you have an arranged marriage, you have a system where you get to know each other. So you grow in love. You develop in knowing each other. But divorce is not allowed. Here where divorce is allowed, we've been so deceived that we jump out of it, because we don't know what marriage is. We jump out of it too quickly, way too quickly. Way too quickly, instead of sitting down understanding that it's not allowed now. If it's not allowed, then we're going to work this problem out. We're going to work this situation out. No, we're running, because unfortunately, we become more self-centered. Kind of answers a question in that area. I generally bring up the question, what's the difference, and I say, don't take this as women particularly, just an attitude, but what's the difference between Sarah and her giving her husband, her wife, her maid, and a young lady nowadays doing that? What does Sarah have going on that, it was just going to get me right into my lesson, that we don't have now, most young ladies now don't have? Don't say the Holy Spirit, because he wasn't born again.
I'm going to venture to say, Sarah had they had a promise, and she didn't think that the promise was being fulfilled. Mm-hmm. So they tried to kind of help God out a little bit,
to do that.
And compare to today, if you see that kind of thing, especially with us, it's like, I ain't going to take that.
Why? Yeah. Because we're not leaning on the promise.
There you go.
We're not leaning on the promise.
Yeah.
In other words, we don't have the faith in God like Sarah did. We don't have that relationship in God like Sarah did. We have the Holy Spirit, and it seems like we should be doing it greater than what Sarah did.
But I can't see a
I'm
wife.
I'm speaking in general now.
In general, yes, I'm talking in general too. A person that a union, even similar to Sarah's and Abraham, the wife nowadays saying, okay, Dee Dee, you can go and be with my husband, so you can do it. I don't see that.
What happens is, this is just change, make it modernize. Don't just say wife, just say relationship people.
A relationship,
man,
okay.
And women.
Right, right.
What happens is, the same situation that came down with Sarah, because we don't lean on the promise, let one spouse or the husband or the wife slip up and get caught in adultery.
Right.
That's why I don't understand.
That's modern.
Open marriages.
Yeah. That's modern. Now what's going to happen? Sarah voluntarily gave her husband, well, had the concept, trying to help God out.
Right.
But ain't that what we're supposed to be doing in ministering to each other? Helping God out. When you minister to somebody, you're helping God. You're helping that person maintain their relationship with God. You're helping God out.
So are you saying that, because you're not saying that it was okay with what Sarah did, because there was issues.
No. I'm looking at that frame of mind. Yeah. You're looking at that frame of mind, state of mind. Why? It was a bunch of issues. Matter of fact, God bless me, just opened my eyes here just last week. You know there's only one married couple in the Hall of Fame of Faith?
Abraham and Sarah.
Mm-hmm. Only one married couple in the Hall of Fame. But we're both, there were some married people in there where only one was mentioned. But far both couples being mentioned, it's only Abraham's. So it's something that God put that like that for something that we need to be gleaming on. And we're going to gleam on that. We're going to get more into that relationship between Sarah and Abraham.
Am I wrong in thinking the promise was given to Abraham that he was going, that God was going to make him the father of many nations? The promise was given to Abraham,
yes,
not to Sarah.
In a married couple, and we're gonna start off here. You're going a little deeper than what, but I'm gonna address it. If you love somebody, what do? You want to see the best for them. You want to see what God has for them.
Right.
What Sarah was acting out of was showing you, I'm going to get into it, it's love. She was showing you what love does, what love sacrifices self. Love gives. Okay. Love gives of self in a way that is a sacrifice. That's what love do. Sarah expressed a very strong sense of love. Very strong. Abraham, but her love for God.
But that love was conditional, though.
It was.
You know why it was conditional? Because she, after, what's her name? Hagar got pregnant and all. She despised her. And sent her away. So if it had not been unconditional, she would have embraced her and kept her in. So
not that the love was unconditional, but the love wasn't pure enough or strong enough to go through the process of maintaining, because when a little diversity came in, it broke.
So wasn't that conditional?
That's not conditional. When you say conditional, to me, mean in order for me to do this, you got to have that. It already was done. The act of between Sarah and Abraham, not the act between Sarah and Hagar, but the act between Sarah and Abraham has already been done. So it wasn't conditional. And that Hagar is just kind of like a byproduct, but the love, the relationship is between Sarah and Hagar. What we want to look at it is what was going on between Sarah, Sarah and Abraham, not Sarah and Hagar. Sarah and Hagar kind of shows you some things that can go on that can distort and mess up problems that can come in.
But you know what? But Hagar, you know, gave Sarah a bad feeling. You know, she kind of gave her.
She taunted her.
Yeah, right.
But until then, Sarah was okay.
Until Hagar
said, look at me.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
She's like, okay.
Is that what the devil does when you want to get you away from your promise?
To bring it down on a contemporary level, isn't that what happened? You mentioned adultery earlier. Isn't that what happened when there's a mistress or somebody involved?
Yep.
You can't keep your man, you know, that kind of thing.
We're talking about the schemes of the devil. Well, the devil just do all kinds of crazy mess. But yes, ma'am.
Excuse me. After a while, Sarah really became very furious with Abraham.
Yeah.
So did she take her love away?
Nope. Being furious with somebody, upset with somebody, or being hurt by someone doesn't mean you take their love away. It just means that now you've got to go to God to maintain. You don't remove. Well, y'all make me go a little further than we want to go. Just because you're strong in your relationship with the Lord doesn't mean people can't hurt you.
That's true.
But what happens is, if you're strong within the Lord, with that hurt, instead of developing in a desire to hurt, it develops in a desire or a compassion to help. Instead of hurting other people. Well, you don't want to lash out. Generally, when we get hurt, when you get hurt and you're outside of the Lord, if somebody hits you upside your head, you want to hit them back. But the Bible tells us to turn the other cheek. When you're in the Lord, you turn the other cheek. How many times have we been taught that? Okay, you ain't really now. Because that lesson's kind of been gone by the wayside.
Okay, but let me ask you a question then. Abraham had the right to say, no, I'm not going to do this. Just like Adam had the right to say, no, I'm not going to eat of this apple. You know, but he didn't. And so that caused confusion right there.
Mm-hmm.
So now what?
We're going to get into that now what when we get into that. We're going to get into that now what.
Yeah.
But first, before we go that far, we got to set some foundations so we can understand where we're going. All right. Let's backtrack just a little bit. Now that we had that quick little discussion, let's go back. Marriage class. We got to establish our definition. What is marriage? Everything is based on these definitions. What is marriage? Come on now. Y'all got to start spewing this stuff out to me. You got to get it down. What's marriage?
Male and female coming together
to reflect the image of God. All right,
all together. What's marriage? Male and female coming together.
All right. So what is love?
God is love.
God is love and God is spirit. God is love and God is spirit. So what is love? God is love and God is spirit. What is covenant?
Unbreakable bond between God and man.
God's commitment to create a relationship with man.
Mm-hmm.
Unbreakable.
That's right.
Unbreakable.
Say it again. Between God and man. All right, I'm gonna have Denise type this out so y'all can have them before your eyes, because these three definitions is the foundation of everything, foundation of all the directions we're gonna go. Instead of really getting to the foundation like we did the previous classes, the Lord laid it on my heart to now deal more in the relationship. But he found, how does these different avenues affect us? How do these different avenues govern the way we do things? What is relationship? Let's take another definition. We're going to stand for this definition of relationship is what we're going to stand on. So definition of relationship is the way in which two or more concepts or objectives or people are connected or in a state of being connected.
Say again.
Relationship, the way in which two or more concepts, objectives, or people are connected or in the state of being connected.
Two or more concepts?
Concepts. Like you can have, how can I say a concept being related? Two theories that are in relationship with each other. That's more of a scientific matter. But what we want to focus on for this definition is the last part, in a state of being connected. Underline that part, in a state of being connected. Relationship is in a state of being connected. And the first part of that, where it says, the way in which to, we're going to turn that way into a word that the Bible more defines it and gives you a better way. When you say way, it's with a direction, right? When you say way, it's kind of a process. So in the Bible, way becomes order. So if you want to read this all the way out from a biblical point of view, it's the order in which two or more stay in a state of connection. The order. Can everybody see that?
Yeah.
A connection. A state of being connected. The order in which two or more are in a state of being connected. The order. So we want to understand that God and his love, and the first part we're gonna get into today. The Lord had me kind of turn this around, because in our previous class we talked about marriage first, then we went to love, then we went to covenant. I think that was the order. But originally when I started doing this class, I would do love, then covenant, then marriage. So we're going to turn it back around. We're going to discuss love first. And then we're going to get into covenant. Then we're going to get into marriage. And we're going to discuss each one of these areas from the perspective of relationship between God and man, the relationship between man and the world, and the relationship between man and male and female. So that's a relationship between God and man, the relationship between man and the world, the relationship between male and female. So today, I just kind of want to, and the relationship between male and female is going to kind of be touched on, because that's kind of the thing about marriage. We're going to kind of hit that as we go, but as we just hit it and back off of it until we get to that area. But right now, we want to just understand this definition. The order in which two or more are in a state of being connected. So this word order coming from God, if we can simplify it just a little bit, without getting too heavy, because in studying this, it gets a little heavy. If I can simplify this in a little bit, and God, and the Bible, from God's perspective, is God's way of doing things, right? Mm-hmm. Anytime we say order, when we talk about God, we're just talking about God's way of doing things. Mm-hmm. So we got to get a strong enough faith that we want to do it God's way of doing it. Mm-hmm. And part of the, a problem with marriage is we're not doing it God's way, are we? Mm-hmm. We're not attempting to do it God's way. We're attempting to do it our way. Mm-hmm. With that thought, and give you something to talk, think on, I'm going to pass these out. And for the next few weeks, or the next 2 weeks, I want you to kind of look at these scriptures, look at the direction. Don't look at what the woman's supposed to do if you're a man, or what the man's supposed to do if you're a woman, but look at it just strictly from your perspective. What is God expecting from me? How can I get strong in my being to be able to?
You're gonna give him a test.
I'm coming that way.
Oh.
I'm not through. Not through yet. There you go. I won't forget.
Okay.
And if I do, just do what you just did. Hey! Give me that. I need one more. You want one? Let me get two more. Yeah. Two more. So focus on that aspect. That what we're trying to do, what we're trying to accomplish is becoming in relationship with God. In other words, in being connected with God, mm-hmm. we're coming into His order. His way of doing things. So if you can grasp that, if you can just grasp that right now, not in your head, but in your heart, you'll see why the Bible says certain things. Why the Bible expresses certain things to be the way they are. Because expressing it and saying it to put you in a position to develop you to do what? What is marriage? Come on, y'all. Y'all got to start putting this together. What is marriage? So, everything in this, in the Bible, all these orders in the Bible, all this way things laid out in the Bible is to develop you to reflect the image and likeness of God.
Right.
To help you become and develop in a way where you're reflecting the image and likeness of God. I'm talking from the perspective of marriage. As an individual, how are we supposed to do this? What do we call? Come on, now that's not that heavy.
I asked the question again, I'm sorry.
I was talking from the aspect of marriage. As individuals, how are we supposed to do this? How are we supposed to reflect the image and likeness of God as individuals? You can't do it in totality, but you can do it in a perspective. What are we? What are we? What are we called when we make that salvation move?
We're Christians.
We're Christians. So what is our strive? What is our direction? What are we trying to do? What is our purpose?
To be Christ-like.
To be Christ-like. Thank you. To be Christ-like. So as individuals, we are to be Christ-like. Mm-hmm. That's putting us in that image, mm-hmm. not in the totality. In that likeness of God. Because in the totality of the marriage of the image and likeness of God, there's one thing we're lacking as an individual. And that's that creative ability. God laid the creation of life in the marriage, not in the individual. And that's basically the only difference. Basically the only difference. But as individuals, we can just about do everything else. I say just about. But as individuals, there's one thing we can do if we go to somebody, but but it becomes a little more difficult. Whereas a marriage, if they got their marriage together, their marriage is centered around God. If their marriage is Holy Ghost filled, they can do it at will. And that's the power of agreement. Says so two or more, well, you got two or more living together. You got two or more intimacy. You got two or more with the Holy Spirit. In the order of what God is all about. God presents himself as what? Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Marriage is what? Male, female, Holy Spirit. And that three cord, and that three band cord is a strength. God.
Yes, yes, yes.
Why do you think the marriage is attacked so tough? Devil don't want you to come to that realization. If you ever came to the realization of what you really represent, what you really capable of as a married couple, a lot of this stuff that's going on right now will not be happening.
That's true.
Wow.
That's why he's attacking the marriage.
Yeah.
Because out of the marriage comes what?
Life.
Life. Out of marriage came a Hitler. Out of a marriage came also a Martin Luther King.
Yeah.
Out of a marriage. I don't mean a marriage meaning that they went down and said they vowed, but anytime a male and female come together as a union to create life, that is biblically considered a marriage. Because Jesus told the Samaritan woman what? She had five?
Yeah, and the
one
was not your husband.
And not your husband. In other words, you went through the marriage process with him, but you didn't go through the legal process with him. So this relationship, first of all, we're going to go back and deal it from this aspect of love. So relationship is what? Thinking about love, y'all. Relationship, that definition, you got to get it down.
The order of
a state of being connected, the order. The order in which two or more are in a state of being connected, the order. Come on, you gotta understand that. The order in which two or more are in a state of being connected. So to fully understand this from a marriage point of view, let's go to Genesis 1:26. Because this is the beginning of it all. Genesis 1:26. Do I have a strong reader or do I need one? We all know this, and every time I'll really go through this, because this is foundationally something we have to really conceive, and it just came to me right now. It just came to me through the Holy Spirit to tell you all to get Joyce Meyer's book. Because a lot of what I'm going to say is going to be like an airplane trying to make a major adjustment. If you jump on it, it's going to throw you out of kilter. So you can't just jump on it, but take it in and start absorbing it. But Joyce Meyer's book, Battlefield of the Mind, will help you in dealing with anything that God has for you that the world has set up a habit or a thought process that is contrary to what God has. And 90% of the time, 99% of the time, is because we have latched on to that worldly perspective, and our pride has gotten into it, and then we begin to reject God. Instead of getting into God and understand that He is true, and because He is true, what are we supposed to seek? Proverbs says the first thing we're supposed to seek when we got truth is to seek understanding.
Yes, yes, yes.
Don't reject it, accept it by faith, but seek understanding, because when you get an understanding of it, it becomes more palatable, becomes more acceptable. It's not like you're fighting. So get Joyce Meyer's book, yes, ma'am.
Well, you know, I just had a thought about the word order, and I kind of want to.
Go ahead, yeah. Always more people like you.
When I got married, I had and still have issues with my husband about order. And I'm talking about order in the worldly sense. You know, he, from time to time, just, you know, it's like he doesn't, he thinks I'm trying to control him. You know, so he's affiliated order with someone trying to control him, okay? And so when you said, you know, it's like the way, you know, that in this particular case, in terms of relationships, is, you know, it's God's order. It's the way of being, you know, is it, the way God is. And so, you know, before you come off of that, it's really important because in relationships, any kind of relationship, we don't see order as a good thing from a worldly sense. Does that make sense?
The world has destroyed that, and you gotta understand that, that who's the prince of this world? Devil. So he's perverting everything.
Exactly.
He's perverting it to get, he's trying to make right, wrong, good, bad.
Exactly.
And he's actually, from a world perspective, he's done a pretty good job here lately. I would agree. But that doesn't mean God's church is not prevailing.
Exactly.
But we have to do, oh man, if we turn that TV off, we turn that TV off, you see God's church. You got a young, you got some young people up here that are on fire. You got some young people that will that know the word and will come flow, I mean, and flow in the spirit, but you don't see that. Mm-hmm. But we got some young people coming up that, ooh. I mean, we're trying to establish it here, but when you get out to church or God's kingdom and you start seeing what's happening in God, just God's kingdom as a whole. Oh man, you got some people throwing some young people ministries that are thousands of them, and they falling out and they just crying and like Pastor said, they get broken in the spirit. And but when we narrow ourselves down to what's going on right around us, we like, oh man, church ain't doing too much, is it? You know? And that TV kind of helps us get narrow-minded instead of breaking out and seeing things from a broader perspective.
But it really isn't. Everything really boils down to order.
Everything boils down to order.
Order.
And we're going to see that. And I was going to ask the question at the end of the class. Maybe I ask it tomorrow. I'm going to put a little contest up. But part of that is order. But order without this other thing gets to be like clamoring bells. And see, that's been the problem. We've had people come in with a sense of order and banging people over the head. Mm-hmm. And so particularly women, well, I can't say that particularly women, but from a female point of view of submission, they have totally missed the whole concept of submission. Mm-hmm. But that's not saying that men from a position of headship has totally missed the whole concept of headship. It goes both ways. We kind of feel similar sensitive towards the women because of the nature of women. They express themselves. But you got men sitting back, ain't saying a word, and torture. They are. Why do you think our jails are filled with more men than women? Men are dying, I mean, emotionally dying every day because they have this wrong concept of what headship is all about. Mm-hmm. And because they do, it goes against something inside them. So where's the battlefield?
Mind.
In the mind.
Yeah.
And they're losing their minds.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But, you know, one last little quick thing about order. I was in the laundry the other day, and there were several machines mm-hmm. with the sign, out of order.
Mm-hmm. Come on now.
And so I'm not leaving this whole thing because we're all out of order. And what we wanna be is in order.
Yep. And that's why you're here. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yes. And I appreciate that.
That's why you're here. But we gotta build this foundation, this sense of order on what God says, because we can even kind of miss it in God. That's why I'm starting this off from the beginning. We can kind of miss it even when we're in God's, when we throw out certain things, because you've had heard a lot of even big ministries make statements in terms of Adam and Eve, that if you went to the Bible, you're like, where did they see that? But they're making it to influence to their congregation. And I have to say this. I say it out loud. But a lot of us, as pastors, fall into the trap of trying to appease the people that we have.
That's it.
And a lot of our churches are about 70% women.
That's true.
So who are we trying to appease? Mm-hmm. And we're scared if we tell the truth that we're going to lose congregation and we're going to lose money. Mm-hmm. Now, I'll put that out there. I'll leave it alone.
Okay. Okay.
So we're going to the back. Let's go to Genesis 1:26. We're going to look at this from a perspective of relationship and what relationship is. The order in which, an order of a state of being connected. The order of a state of being connected. So we got to first look at it from God's point of view. God's the one created this. God started this process of being connected. So how did he start this creation? Genesis 1:26. Then God said, let us make man. See, we got to stop right there because the order has already been established.
Yes.
Right. Yeah.
Let us. Mm-hmm. See, the problem with other religions, why they go off and get so violent and do so much crazy things or sacrificing their kids and doing everything? Because they have a deity that stands alone. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to show you about that deity that stands alone. Mm-hmm. But God said, let us. Meaning God is showing you himself from three different perspectives. Mm-hmm. There's a reason before that. We're talking about love right now. The order of love. So he said, let us make man in our image. So basically we can say that image is in the image of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Without, you don't have to do any studying. You just have to read that and understand that we're talking about Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We're not talking about one person saying, I'm going to make you look like Michael, you know. Everybody going to look like Michael. We're not talking about one, everybody looking like mine. We're talking about three, a Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Yes.
In our image. And according to our likeness. So what that word likeness mean? Anybody ever thought about that? We got image and we got likeness. What are we trying to express? What's God trying to express here? Come on, y'all, talk to me. We got image and we got likeness.
We're supposed to look like him.
Act like him. So what's the image?
To reflect
right here.
Spirit.
Spirit in what? Spirit in Father, Spirit in Son, Spirit in Holy Spirit. That's why when you hear a minister try to relate this to an individual, if you know it, it don't work. Only place this can relate is in the marriage. Only place it can relate to have three operating as one is in the marriage. You say, well, Mr. Mike, I got a spirit, I got a soul, and I got a body. I'm three, but your three has no intelligence for one.
My God.
Your body has no intelligence to think on its own. Your mind really has no intelligence to think on its own. Mm-hmm. All it does is calculate that which you have put into it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's deep. Yeah.
That's the only thing in your mind. Deep. So if you put garbage in, what's coming out?
Yeah. Yes.
Garbage out.
Yes.
And the only thing that has the intelligence to think and change is your spirit.
Your spirit. That one.
But God has Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He tells us in, I wrote it down, I'm trying to memorize it. But the Bible tells us that we've been made a little lower than angels. That's kind of a misconcept, a misword. The writers of the Bible at that time got a little fearful in respect of who God is. The actual Hebrew word doesn't say a little lower than the angels. No. It says a little lower than Elohim himself. He created us as little gods. A lot of people can't conceive that. He created us as little gods.
A little lower than himself.
A little lower than himself.
Yep.
But don't put that on the individual. That's the mistake we made. We got too many people trying to go out here and be a little God without the other part.
Yeah.
A male trying to be a little God without the female. A female trying to be a little God without the male. Because here, let's take this further. So let's go ahead and so we're going to find out. Because when I wake y'all up to what marriage is, you're going to see marriage all through this Bible. Everything has to deal with marriage. This concept of marriage is so heavy and so deep that God himself even made the relationship of his relationship between him and Israel. He was marrying them. They were his wife. And the greatest relationship that we're in is what? Jesus is going to marry the church.
Yes.
This concept of marriage, oh man. That God himself is using it to reflect his relationship between him and man. A marriage. So we really need to understand what it is we want to get into. So let's take a little further. So in an image and according to his likeness. So we established that his likeness is the way he is, the way he acts. And his image is the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Then it says, let them. It didn't say let him.
It said let them.
It says let them. Who is the them?
The Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
No.
Male and female.
Male and female. We're going to get to that.
Okay.
It says let them have dominion over the fish fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creepy thing that creepeth on the earth. So in that paragraph alone, he's already established some things that you cannot ignore. First of all, he said, let us, he didn't say individual. Second of all, he said, his image and likeness. He didn't say, we're going to make them look like Jupiter. Women, what was that book? Men are from Mars and women are from Jupiter. Some little crazy. Some crazy dust like that. Now, can I say this? This society has got us so socked up that they think there's a major difference between male and female. That it's so vast that you got men believing they can't understand women and women believe they can't understand men. All you got to do, particularly with a godly individual, I'm like, here's the clue. All you have to do is look at God. Because women are reflecting one part of God, and men are reflecting another part of God. If you want to understand each other, look at God. If you want to understand, men want to understand women, look at the compassion. Look at the nurturing aspect of who God is. I heard one guy, I haven't studied this out yet, but I'm going to make the statement. I generally don't make statements of stuff I haven't studied out, but I heard of one guy in my class made the relationship between the Holy Spirit and women.
Wow.
And if you think about it, you understand what submission is. The Holy Spirit is all power.
Yeah.
I mean, this is all power. Holy Spirit. God the Father said he was all power. He said the power is in the Holy Spirit. Do y'all hear me? But the Holy Spirit, having all that, still submit himself to the Father. And even unto Jesus, he says, I do nothing but what the Father tells me. So submission is an ultimate act of taking who you are in totality and putting it up under someone else. All your abilities and giving it to someone else. going to get into this when we get into marriage, because the Jewish marriage reflects a lot of this. We're going to study, when we get into the marriage part, we're going to study the Jewish marriage. But getting a little ahead of myself there. It's hard not to, you know. I just want to say, here it is, y'all, go for it. You know? Take it off. It's hard not, because you know, I know the end. But okay, dominion over, where was I? Dominion over fish, over creepy things. So God created what? Man. All right, order. There's order again. He created what?
Man.
How do we know that there's an order here? Because before there was Adam and Eve, there was
man.
But we're going to go on and find that out. So he's starting that order. He created man. He didn't say man totality was in his image, but he said created man. If we want to put a comma there, it changed this whole thing. But he said created man in his image. In his image, God created him male and female. So man, we can also say, was created male and female. But we understand that Adam had the totality of what God was all about. And Adam was male and female, if you want to put it that way, because woman came what?
Out of his rib.
So woman came out of his rib. That means God took a piece of him to create woman. So now, basic concept would tell you, as Adam was created in the totality of what God is, now he's not in that totality, but now a piece of him is taken away to create woman. So he cannot reflect the totality of what God is because it's been taken away. Part has been taken away. That's basic common sense would tell you that. If we don't get hung up on religion and all this other conditioning to try to shield us from what God is actually saying here. Don't get quiet on me, y'all. I hear you out there. Don't get quiet on me. It's going to be all right. So God created him in his own image. In the image of God, he created him male and female. He created them. Male and female, he created them. So he created the mankind. He created male and female. And we learned before that Jesus is the one that established this by saying to the Pharisees, why would you try to ask me about divorce back in Matthew 9? Why would you ask me about divorce? They was trying to tempt him when you don't understand that he, in the beginning he created them male and female, talking about the marriage. All right, just in that, come on now, y'all don't have to talk to me. I showed you order, so where's the relationship in this order? Where's the relationship in this order? We got Father, Son, Holy Spirit, let us. We got in their image and likeness. And we got man, then we got male and female. So where's the relationship in this order? What is happening here in this order?
I think it's all the way through it.
Speak up, come on.
So I think it's all the way through it because first you got the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
Then falling up under him is man and then female.
Man, then female. Well, if you want to stay up, man, then male and female.
They're all connected.
All male, they're all
connected.
What?
They're all connected.
So when we talk about relationship, an order of connection.
Yeah.
They're all connected. They're all connected. For the sake of time, let's jump a little ahead, because I have to show you something. Everybody knows what happened in the original sin. What happened in the original sin? Original sin, what we call original sin, we had Eve being deceived by the serpent, right? Then Eve gave Adam the apple and he bit it, right? And then that's where the sin fell off. Can anybody see what happened there by what I've just told you? You're talking about relationship. What happened? Don't get off into a sin thing in terms of they just sinned, but what actually what the sin was, I know a lot of big ministers, a lot of people will say what the sin was because of Adam disobeying God. Let's look at the total relationship. Don't look at Adam. Look at
just out of order.
Well, you hit it. Out of order. What happened in terms of out of order? Explain that out of order.
The two were out of order.
They were out of order. Okay. Order and being connected. Before the original sin, they were connected. Now, I'm going to propose this to you. Don't make this a doctrine, but I'm going to make the proposal. Eve told the serpent, we are not to eat or touch of the tree.
Right.
To understand order, I'm going to propose this to you, that God didn't tell Eve that. Adam did.
Adam did, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Adam told Eve that. To try to build up something a little more, to protect it a little more, because you know how you pass something down, it grows a little bit. He wanted to flex his muscle a little bit, so he's going to tell you, you don't touch it either. Mm-hmm. Understand it. Don't make a doctrine out of that, because it still doesn't demean the fact that there's an order here. But in that, when Eve became deceived, she got out of order. And how did she get out of order? She made a decision.
She made
decision
to talk to the serpent.
Well, but that was that, no, she had her right. Don't let nobody take your right as a woman to do what you want to do. But when you're married, the out of orderness is when you make a decision not to include your husband.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
All right, hear me. Y'all getting there now. So Adam did what? Adam then made what?
Decision
not to include God. Oh, y'all getting it, y'all. Here we go. Yeah. So we're talking about order here. So y'all getting to understand this marriage thing a little better now. It's all about an order, all about a connection. All about a connection to stay connected with who?
God.
To stay connected with God. So we got people walking around and they're doing their little thing. And they think they're connected with God, but they're not connected with God, because you can tell them by their fruit, because the fruit is not producing anything of the Holy Spirit. And we got major ministries going on. I keep saying this because I want to get your mind free so you don't be deceived, because we're in a time right now the deception is going real wild.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we got major ministries that you don't see any fruit of the Spirit.
That's it.
Healings. We got a ton of people. The movement of the Spirit. Even Jesus himself said, what? The gate, I'm paraphrasing, the gate unto the world is wide, but salvation is small.
Yeah.
So don't be deceived by what you see in terms of big ministries and big this and big that. What you want to look for is what? Say it again.
The fruit.
Before you look for the fruit, what you got to look for?
Order.
You got to keep that in order, because Satan himself is going to come during this time performing healings, but he won't be in order. Mm-hmm. He can't get in order.
Mm-hmm. Jesus.
Mm-hmm. So the first thing you have to look for is the order. And that's what we're supposed to be teaching and developing. And the reason why the marriage is being so attacked is teaching our kids order.
Right.
Order in the different aspects of what are we talking about now? Love.
Just interject something.
Come on.
I'm just blown away. I mean, last week I was blown away and convicted, and so today I'm blown away again and further convicted. Just in terms of that whole order thing, I'm not like.
That's because y'all. While she's talking, everybody turns to Genesis 2:18.
Okay, so I'm not like putting myself down, but I can see.
No, don't put yourself down.
No, I can see. Okay, this is my husband and I just on was it Thursday? Thursday, we've been here for 90 days. 90 days. And we were talking about this earlier. It's taken all this time for me to get here, to be connected
and rooted in a church home that is in order to bring me in order.
Yes.
Okay? In my marriage, you know, in my family, and the whole ball of wax. So I'm just like, whoa.
She just stated what
this is no accident.
And you know, you just stated Ephesians. You just stated Ephesians. For God was in Ephesians 2, which says, gives the order of marriage. Mm-hmm. And then Paul says, what? This is the church.
Yeah.
So the marriage and the church is supposed to do things in the same order, the same way, to support each other, to create the same thing. The marriage creates it out of life. The church takes that what the marriage might have missed, and what you say, brought you in, back into order.
Yes.
Church is supposed to bring you back. So God got you covered, that boat. Got your front and your back.
Deep
confirmation.
God has got your front and your back. I used to tell everybody, I was joking with people a lot. When you walk into church, do you walk into the front door or the back door? Think about it. When you walk into a church, do you walk into the front door or the back door?
Front door.
Huh?
Front door.
No, you don't. Because the front of the church is where the sanctuary is. You're walking in the back door.
Back door. Wow.
That's right. That's true. That's it.
Now, through the marriage, creating holy people, creating priests, where are they? Up front.
Up front.
Wow. This is just
up front.
You could just stop right there.
Up front. Come on, y'all don't let Barbara just participate in this. Come on, y'all. Just don't be afraid to voice your opinion, because we all got some. I've been into this for a while. Every time I turn around, the Lord showed me something that slaps me upside the head and says, hey, you think you ain't got it right yet. You know? So just voice it. Now, I've learned the reason why I like this environment, because we used to do it in our home, and the reason I like this environment, because in order to get something in you, I've got to take something out of you. Mm-hmm. And the only way you can get it out of you is to voice it.
Mm-hmm.
So talk it. This is not a preaching session. It's going to minister to you, but I like to do this in a way where you can avoid, I don't care how out there your opinion may be, voice it. Nobody here is going to criticize you. They better not let me criticize you. Because if you're going to criticize somebody, whether the saying is, you're going to criticize, if you're going to talk about somebody's dirty feet, just prepare to wash them. If you can't wash nobody's feet, you ain't got no business talking about them.
It wasn't about what you said, it was about something else he said to me. It wasn't about the class or anything you said. It was something he whispered to me.
I just love my pastor. They just keep it so real. And that's what we need.
It's all good.
That we can tell.
Okay, let me get this in, because I've got to have Denise's Corner. Got to make room for Denise's Corner. Everybody want to hear Denise's Corner, right?
Yeah.
So I'm going to hit this, but we'll pick it up next week. Genesis 2:18. Understand this order. All right. We understand that, we're talking about love now. We understand that God said he created man in his own image. We understand that the marriage was male and female. But before the marriage, he created man. He created Adam. He knew what he had to do. So in Genesis 2:18 it says, and the Lord said, and this is what you got to understand, mm-hmm. because a lot of people have warped this and took it off. He said, it is not good for man to be alone. Mm-hmm. It is not good for man to be alone. Mm-hmm. Now, we all intelligent people right here. He's already created Adam in his name. Adam has that totality of what God is. And God is what? God is what? God is love. So Adam has been created in the totality of love. Why would it be good for Adam to be alone? Not because he needed somebody to help him with his intellect. This man is naming the animals. And if you want to get into that real deep from the Hebrew point of view, he wasn't just naming the animals, he was pronouncing them into existence.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He was pronouncing them into existence. He gave them their purpose and their being, pronouncing them into existence. Now, being like this, why wouldn't it be good for a being like this to be alone? Why would God say that it's not good for him to be alone?
You need to share his love.
Mm-hmm. Self-centered. Well, those who've been in class before, God himself don't present himself alone, because if he presented himself alone, he couldn't express and show you what love is. He couldn't give his son. So Adam being like God in the totality, in one being, it is not good, because now Adam, which is love, has nothing outside of itself to love. Nothing outside of itself to express what love is. Nothing outside of himself to be that is like him. So if Adam stayed in that state, and we have an example of that, we have a being created by Adam that was only one and stayed in the state of only one. Can we think about it? Who was that?
Satan.
And what happened to Satan? He became consumed with himself. He became consumed with himself. He just put it right there. So God said, that ain't happening with my man, child. He is not becoming consumed with himself. So it is not good for him to be alone. So he created Eve. Now Adam has something outside of himself to show what love is. Everybody understand?
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm going to leave you right there. Anybody learn anything today?
Yeah.
Y'all pick up something today?
Yes.
Get those definitions, because those definitions are the foundation which you're going to stand on. If you can get those definitions down and you hear things or see things and they don't line up with that definition, the light going to go off in your head and make you think. Is there a deception going on here? Now, you have a quick question? Go ahead.
Mm-mm, I don't have this paper right here.
The
marriage paper. I didn't get one.
Which one?
This one right here, the marriage of original intent.
Without further ado, let's give a hand for Denise Turner. Yay!
Thank you, everybody. You know, it's kind of funny. I was talking to the Lord a couple of days ago, and I said, you know, I don't have anything to say. What should I say tonight? And so God just started talking, you know, and I was like, okay, wait a minute. Let me get some paper and pencil and write this down, you know? I mean, it was just rattling. I mean, you know, and the way I hear from God, what I hear, I verbalize. And so I'm verbalizing this, and I'm like, wait a minute, I need to write this down because I know I'm going to forget some of it. And the first thing that I wrote down was what Michael ended on tonight.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And this came to me 2 days ago, maybe 3 days ago. And it's a good thing, because I've been so busy ever since, even today, not to have time to have something to say. So what he first gave me was help meet. Who's the help meet in the relationship?
The wife.
The wife is the help meet. And then Michael talked about being out of order. And one of my positions when we do marriage counseling, we haven't done it in a while, but when we do marriage counseling, is always talking to the wife to find out if she's out of order. And I come in real hard with them on being out of order. You know, because the wife is always the one complaining. You know, this ain't right, and I'm like this, and and I'm trying to do this, and he ain't, you know. And most of the time, we're out of order. Mm-hmm. You know, now there are times in a marriage that you may have to step up. You know, where there's a deficiency in the husband. But then our problem is, God equips us to handle that deficiency. But we don't want to, and we kind of like that power, you know? Yeah. You know, now we're in control, we get this thing going, you know, but we forget that God will come back, and because while you're doing that, God is building up that husband. And so when he's ready to take back that leadership that is rightfully his position, we women don't want to give it up. Wow. And then there's a big struggle and a fight.
That's true.
I mean, it can get on. You know, and so I have a big thing about women, get back in your position. Because if you get back in your position, because what did Michael just say? Our position is similar to who?
The Holy Spirit.
It is. But we have to submit back. We have to move back and let the Holy Spirit work through us. And that's a powerful position that we are in as women. So we don't have to usurp the husband to feel like we're in position or in control, you know, because the helpmeet is a powerful position. And a lot of wives forget that, how important that is. You got enough on your hands to deal with. And so some of the things that he told me was, in the help me is to build up your man and build up your children. Mm-hmm. Nurturing is part of the wife, mother position, is nurturing. You know, and so those two things, to build up your husband, why is that necessary? Now, we both, you know, back, well, there's still some people, because there's a couple I'm dealing with now that stay at home. You know, it's kind of rare that you have that you have wives at home, but there are some still out there. But still, the thing is that in a man's position, you know, he goes out and he works every day and he's running into all types of stuff going on. And if he can't come back to the home and get refueled and filled up, you know, so he can go back out again in the world, you know, so that makes our position very important. Yes. That means we got to be sensitive and understand and just, you know, and depending on the Holy Spirit to say, Holy Spirit, tell me what's going on. How do I minister to him? Mm-hmm. You know, what is it that he needs? Mm-hmm. You know, because, you know, I'm going to use a generality. A lot of times men don't talk. Mm-hmm. You know, they react, but they don't talk a lot. Mm-hmm. So then we have to rely on the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, tell me what's going on. You know, same way with our kids. You know, some kids could be bullied. You know, and you got to know how to deal with that. You know, and it's best not to deal with it in the flesh.
Yeah.
It's best to deal with it in the spirit.
That's right.
You know, and just the kids learning how to be kids, teach them how to be respectful, you know, teach them how to, you know, be interested in school and doing things. You know, when your kids get in trouble, you know, the Holy Spirit's going to tell you. Mm-hmm. You can attest to that, Aquina. Mm-hmm. Right, Gwenita? Mm-hmm. You know, the Holy Spirit will tell you. All you got to do is ask. Mm-hmm. He'll tell you what's going on with your kids. Mm-hmm. You know, and we need to seek God to find out what our kids need, mm-hmm. and how to deal with them. God knows them more than you do. You think you know your kids, you know, but to discipline them, you really need to get God in on the picture, you know, because we shouldn't be reacting to the kids. We need to be finding out what we need to do, because when we see God, then we can get the problem resolved instantly. You know, so we should always be seeking God on any and everything that we're doing. You know, it may sound like a cliche, but it's not. You know, you wouldn't be sweating bullets and worrying about this, that, and the other if you sought God on each and everything. You know, and as you develop that, I had a little, was he a nephew or was he a cousin? I think he was a cousin. He's a cousin. Little young guy, and he was out. He was staying with us, and he was out. And I looked at the clock, and I said, I said, man, he needs to be coming on in pretty soon, you know. I said, Lord, I said, he needs to get home like now. Mm-hmm. And soon after, minutes after I said that, the phone rang. Mm-hmm. Denise, I'm on my way home. I was like, okay, that was good. Wow, that was quick. Got my answer like just like that, you know?
Yeah.
You know, but I saw God, you know, for help and assistance instead of going through a panic.
Yeah.
You know? Mm-hmm. So let's see, what else did he tell me here to tell y'all? You know, God, he's saying here that, you know, just to remind them, he said that I am faithful. You can depend on me seek and ask me and help you how to guide you in every situation that comes up. You don't have to be in fear about anything. You know, you can, you know, and the more we love each other, the more that we can do for each other. You know, we've got to love. Love has got to be the first thing that comes in, you know, comes out of our mouth, you know. And as I was telling somebody, you know, I said, you know, love's got to show on your face, you know. It's got to show, because love draws you. And if you're frowning and looking mean and mad, you know, you're not inviting for anyone to want to approach you. You know, your kids either. They don't want to approach you when you're frowning and mad and all upset. You know, it's like, well, I think I need to see mom a little later. You know, if she gets a little better. You know, so we should always have love on our face and be willing to attract people to come and talk to you, you know. And I'm speaking of in general now, but mainly your children. You know, you want them to be able to come and when they come, they ought to receive love from you, you know, not a condemnation, not putting you down, you know. And one of my little pet things is, When I'm counseling with married couples, is the more that we pray, the less nagging that we have to do. Mm-hmm. You know, if we pray more and we nag less, so our praying is what we want to see changes in whatever situation it is. If we pray about it more so than going to that person and nagging, you know, you'll see results much, much faster. Anybody got any questions?
That's good.
Okay, another thing here, I just looked at it here, is that, and I'm speaking from a women's point of view, because that's the only view that I can give y'all. and you know, that we have to learn to hear from God. And you know, a lot of times we have a lot to say. You know, we can just go on and on and on, you know. But I've had situations where the Lord just tell me, shut up. Mm-hmm. Don't say no more. Mm-hmm. Enough is enough. Yep. And at first I was like, I'm sure the Lord didn't tell me shut up. When it first happened, I was like, don't tell me shut up. You know, but when it first happened, he was telling me that when Michael and I were in an argument, and we were going back and forth, you know, and Michael and I are both strong-willed people. You know, and God would just say, shut up. You're like, who said that? But it's very important, though. A lot of times when we're in when we're in a conversation, or I should say an argument, you know, sometimes God will tell you, it's time to shut up. Mm-hmm. You know, take it up with me. Mm-hmm. You know, not in an argument, because in our relationship, we're not supposed to, in an argument, because in an argument, you know, you're going tit for tat.
Yeah.
You know, as we call it from Detroit, you know, we play the dozens, you know. But sometimes, it, you know, I'm talking about your mama, you know. You know, and we go at it, you know. And so you get in that study, you get in that argument, you know, and you're just going at it. You know, I'm hurting your feelings, you're hurting mine, I'm hurting yours. You know, and the guy would just say, shut up, stop talking.
Yeah.
Enough is enough. Because that's not what we're supposed to do. We're supposed to build each other up.
Right, right.
So, you know, the old saying, if you can't say nothing good,
don't
say nothing.
Out.
You know,
yeah.
I think that was from God.
Yeah.
You know, it's time to shut up, you know, because now you're tearing down. So now you're over in whose camp are you over in?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, you're in the wrong camp.
Yeah.
You know, so we've got to stay in God's camp.
Yes, Lord.
You know, and so that's with the love. You know, kindness, building up, edifying, you know, all those good things. You know, when we start tearing down, we're over in the wrong camp.
Mm-hmm.
So God says, shut up.
Mm-hmm.
Just stop it. So that's all I got for you right
and
now.
I just want to say real
hold on.
Okay. I just want to say, when you get in that camp, nobody wins.
Exactly.
You don't win. You're just chopping at each other.
That is so true.
Exactly. Yeah. You're tearing each other up. You're pulling each other down. You know, and Satan wins.
That's right.
That's true.
And you never want Satan to win. I mean, I don't care under no circumstances do you want Satan to win.
Exactly.
Now, what were you going to say, Marla?
I just have a little comment about that whole strong-willed. You know, how that really relates to your will being out of order.
Right.
Okay?
So
that's just key. I have to be able to connect the dots.
Yes.
Earlier I told you I'm a dot connector.
Right.
So
right.
That's what I'm doing. So thank you.
You're very welcome.
Okay.
That's good.
Let's give a hand.
Yay!
All right, about that time, I'd like to thank each and every one of you for being here today. It's been kind of feeling for me also. God kind of reveals them. Y'all know, as I'm talking to you, y'all, Holy Spirit's talking to me. And sometimes He tells me things that I can't really relate at the moment. But it's coming down. We're going to get there. Anybody have any questions before we leave? Go ahead.
From last week, Sister Denise shared the, I can't remember, the box. Was that something that you had printed?
Oh,
or
yeah, marriage box.
Marriage
I have
box.
A copy of it.
Yes.
Oh, you
will you want a copy?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'll y'all want it?
Yeah.
Okay.
I can just take a picture of it.
We can make up a copy and a bunch of have it for next week for everybody.
You can make them at the
here, I have it.
I mean, but I don't want it
right.
Yeah,
like that. She ain't running down. She ain't
running down. All right.
And somebody else, we have a copy of
it. I'm a man, truly a man of order. I've got enough of you to say. Denise, she has one.
Here's one, envelope.
Oh, okay. Never mind, Denise.
And I'm so respectful of this thing called order that to end my day in something like this, I have to have the man, the head of this situation, the head of my life physically, my spiritual father, prayers out of here. But I feel covered.
Amen.
So in order for me to feel covered, Pastor Hill, can you pray? Evening prayer.
Father, we thank you for your spirit. We thank you for your grace. And Lord, it's the grace of God that enable us, Lord, to fulfill our roles and responsibilities in our relationships. Father, we commit our relationships to you. You're able, God, to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before your presence with exceeding great joy. Father,
yes,
we thank you for all of the promises that you have given us and all of these promises are yea and amen.
Yes.
Father,
yes,
we thank you for the ability that you have placed within us. You have given us the will and the ability to do all that you have demanded and required of us. And Father, we thank you for the Holy Spirit that's at work in us now.
Yes.
He effectually worketh in all of them that believe. And Father, we yield to him. He's the author and he's the finisher. Lord, we thank you tonight for your grace is sufficient and you're able to cause all grace to abound toward us so we will have sufficiency in everything.
Give you
praise and glory. May the grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Ghost rest and abide with us and bring us back at the appointed time. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Hey, give somebody a hug before you get out of here.
Love
on everybody.
God bless you. Thank you for coming.